Researchers from Georgia Tech, in collaboration with Tianjin University in China, have developed a new semiconductor material. With this new technology, we will be able to build computer chips that will run orders of magnitude faster than ever. And this could really spark a new era in electronics. As a chip designer, I'm very excited about this work. Let me explain why. According to Moore's law, the number of transistors in a chip doubles approximately every 2 years. This observation was first described by Gordon Moore in 1965. However, later, Moore himself predicted that this rate would eventually slow down. And that's unfortunately true. It's getting harder and even more expensive to fit more and more transistors into a single silicon die. It seems like we are hitting some hard physical limits, such as the size of a single atom. Still, there are lots of efforts made by companies like TSMC, IBM, iMac, and Intel to continue shrinking transistors even further and keep Moore's law going indefinitely. Right now, we are in the ballpark of about 200 million transistors per square millimeter, and that's an impressive number. And according to this chart from IEEE, the number of transistors per square millimeter has increased nearly 600,000 times over the last 5 decades. However, further scaling the transistor technology down is a huge challenge. So in order to move the needle forward, we are starting to build in the third dimension, start stacking transistors on top of each other in order to be able to fit more of them in the same area. Imagine it like a big, densely populated city starting to grow vertically. But here, again, we see a new problem emerging, because vertically stacked devices badly suffer from heat dissipation problem. There is no heat dissipation path, which leads to overheating. IBM is trying to address this problem. For example, last year they've introduced vertical transistors, and that's a novel architecture where the gate is placed vertically. However, these devices are still in the research phase. And meanwhile, researchers are constantly looking for new and novel semiconductor materials that can offer better speed and heat dissipation than silicon and potentially replace it. And for a long time, the researchers were investigating graphene as a possibility. And graphene is really appealing due to its particular crystal structure and its exceptional ability to dissipate heat. In fact, it has much higher thermal conductivity than silicon. And as you know, heat is one of the major bottlenecks for many modern electronic devices. This is super important. When chips are becoming smaller and smaller and more densely packed, you don't want your phone to overheat, for example, because overheating degrades the performance and also the lifespan of the device and can even cause a meltdown. So these new graphene-based devices, they are much better at thermal management.
The good thing about graphene is not only can you make things smaller and faster and with less heat dissipation, you're actually using properties of electrons that are not accessible in silicon.
However, there is one fundamental problem with graphene. It's actually not a semiconductor. It has zero band gap, zero electron volt band gap. And this reminds me of time when I was a student and we had classes on semiconductor physics, and it was extremely challenging, but I loved it. So let me explain why band gap in semiconductors is such a big deal. You know, all the modern microchips, like CPUs, GPUs, they're built of transistors, which are, in my humble opinion, the most important invention in the history of humanity. And transistors are essentially tiny switches which can be turned on and off, and their state is basically controlled by the voltage applied to the control terminal. So the band gap in transistors is fundamental because it determines a minimum energy required to make a transistor to switch between the states. Ideally, we would like to have a transistor with the band gap small enough to allow some conductivity, but also not too high, otherwise it's an insulator, and also not too small, like in case of graphene. It's zero. It means it becomes highly conductive, similar to metals, and essentially it's a semi-metal. You see, this zero band gap of graphene is a fundamental problem because we can't make a graphene transistor to switch. However, in this work, the researchers found a way to make a perfect semiconductor out of graphene. What they did, they grew graphene on top of a silicon carbide wafer. And that's pretty sick. In the fab, they heated up silicon carbide to very high temperatures, over 1000 degrees Celsius, and then doped it. Actually, doping a semiconductor has nothing to do with banned or forbidden substances. It's actually adding impurities into material to alter its electrical properties. Actually, silicon, which is used in all the modern chips, is also always doped. So it's doped. By altering the very properties of graphene, they've managed to introduce a band gap. And they called this new semiconductor semiconducting epigraphene, or shortly SEG. Unfortunately, I happen to know that about 60% of you guys who are watching this video are not subscribed to the channel. If you have ever enjoyed my videos, could you please do me a favor and subscribe to the channel? This helps the channel more than you know. The bigger the channel gets, the bigger the guests that I can interview for you get. Thank you. Here is a sneak peek at an epigraphene transistor. I would call it back to square one, an old school planar transistor. All this semiconductor story started with a planar transistor back in 1957. Since then, the transistors have evolved significantly. We went from a planar transistor to FinFET to gate all around, and then to CFET, complementary FET, and then even to vertical transistors. But with this new semiconductor, we started all over again with planar transistor. You see here, the device is built on top of a silicon carbide substrate, and the semiconducting graphene is in the channel. To put it simple, when a gate-to-source voltage is bigger than a certain threshold, the transistor is turned on and the current is flowing through the channel. I don't know if I go too much into the details. Let me know in the comments. What cool is that these new transistors can switch very quickly. They can support frequencies in the range of teragertz. And this is possible thanks to very high electron mobility of graphene. Actually, they're able to achieve 10 times higher electron mobility with graphene than of what was till today possible with silicon chips. And the mobility is defined by crystal structure. The flatness and the band structure of the graphene allows electron to move ballistically. And in practice, this means that an electron can move much faster through a semiconductor, which promises much faster chips with less heat dissipation. What's also promising about this work is that the manufacturing process they used is compatible with a conventional manufacturing process. So overall, it seems like an economically viable technology. And what's even more fascinating is that they've not just managed to make a single graphene-based chip in a lab, but they've managed to fabricate it in large quantity on large silicon carbide wafers, defect-free. And this is a big deal, because usually it's a huge and time-consuming challenge to make a new semiconductor technology to be manufacturable at scale. I think if we can figure out the graphene-based chips, this will be huge. But there are still many technical challenges to overcome until we can bring it to mass production. As always, let me know what you think in the comments. Actually, the whole idea is not to integrate this new technology with traditional silicon technology, as it often happens, but rather to use it with silicon carbide technology, which is already well developed. Silicon carbide is replacing silicon in high voltage applications, such as in power electronics in electric cars. For example, it's widely used in Tesla for powertrain and other applications. And the reason is because of its amazing properties to operate at higher temperatures, to withstand higher resistance and higher electric fields. Another discovery, I believe from a year ago or so, is boron arsenide, another potential candidate to replace good old silicon due to its amazing properties. It has improved charge mobility over silicon and better heat conductivity, 10 times higher thermal conductivity than silicon. This has huge potential. However, researchers found it hard to fabricate boron arsenide at high volume, defect-free. You know that silicon is fabricated quite cheaply, in high quality, and the whole manufacturing process is very well established. But maybe with enough efforts and also sufficient investment, we can also develop boron arsenide. But it will definitely take time, as it took several decades for silicon. If you enjoyed this video, please do me a favor and share this video on your social media with your friends and family. This will make me very happy. And in case you want to support my work, to support the channel, you can join the Patreon through the link below. Thank you so much for watching, and I will see you in the next video. Ciao!